Hello and welcome to Bay One. This is Jafar Moraxi doing an overview of the maximum loadout patch for Robocraft. It's due tomorrow, or by the time most of you read this, it'll actually be today. So it's actually due out on Wednesday as opposed to a Thursday, which is a slightly different move by the Free Jam team, but it's already been delayed by a week, so we can kind of understand that. And if I'm speaking a little bit quickly, it's because I was trying to do a live recording of this and the streaming stuff just isn't working properly. So I'm having to do a file recording and upload it and all that. But anyway, so this is like the third or fourth time I've tried to do this. So anyway, here we are. So obviously there's the two reveals in terms of the blink module and the disk shield module, which are going to be coming out. There's a little bit more revealed about the functionality of those. So basically the blink module, it allows your robot to jump from one position to another based on where the targeting reticle is. You will need to assign it to a loadout key, which based on description of how the loadout system is going to work, it may take up one of your configuration slots, which would be a little bit weird, but we'll see exactly how that works. So that's just a supposition at the moment. You aim a crosshair where you want it to go, and you press the key to activate, and you blink or teleport to that location. It will teleport to the location on the ground if you've got the ground targeted, or it will go into the air at the maximum range of the blink module, depending on, you know, how you got things configured. And you have to play around to see what the actual maximum range is. It's got it uses a lot of power, and it also has a relatively long recharge time. So if you're expecting to be able to jump to things and spam a bunch of fire, you may need to reconsider on that. So we'll see exactly how that works. The next one is the disk shield module. This is a deployable shield. It stays up similar to the home gate, the fusion shield around the base at the beginning of the game in battle mode. So it allows you to just deploy a small version of that. It's only a small disk area. It created the location of your crosshair in the shape of the disc. It works similarly to blink in the, if you point it into the air, it will be the shield will be made at the maximum range of the shield module. So I'm expecting that to be probably about 4 or 5 robot lengths, so you can have it deployed a fair distance away and at least use it to provide some cover against air or something like that, which will be useful. Especially if you've got a lot of people using these, you can definitely, in theory, create a decent umbrella. It uses less power than blink, but has a longer recharge time. And yeah, I've already described the on the ground and on the air thing, and you'll need to practice with it to get a feel for the actual range. And that's probably code word for saying they may adjust the range depending on how gameplay works, but we'll see. The next one, the new loadout system. So this is probably going to be, outside of the two modules, probably the biggest change to the entire game, because it's going to force a redesign of a lot of robots in order to cope with this kind of stuff. I mean, if you only want to use one loadout, then you don't need to do anything, but really for adaptability, you're going to want to have multiple loadouts for a single design. So you'll be able to put many different weapon types on a single robot. You have 5 assignment slots for the loadout system, so you'll be able to assign a key to each particular loadout. Each weapon class or module you add takes a slot, so in terms of weapon class, that would be the ability to have nanos, plasma, SMGs, the mega versions and the standard versions are considered the same type of weapon. And then, or the modules, so say you wanted to have a shield module and a blink module on the same robot, you'll actually have different loadouts for those, apparently. So, well, not loadouts, but you would take out two of your keys, so maybe four and five would be the blink module, the shield module, and the other three would actually be different weapon configurations. So as you add new weapons or modules to the robot, the system pops up and asks you to assign it to a slot. Using this, you can easily arrange your assignments. You can also bring up the loadout system dialog by pressing Z when building, so you can tweak your loadout at any time. Now, something that isn't really being clarified here is how will this work with a particular single weapon type. Say you've got 12 SMGs you want on your robot. Can you assign half of them to one loadout and the other half to a different loadout slot or something? Or yeah, that's going to be somewhat interesting to see. The other one here, your loadout is saved separately for each robot in your garage. Top mount a laser wasp and front mount laser wasp are the same class, so share a slot, whereas laser wasp and laser blaster are in different classes, so we'll take out different slots. In combat, pushing the key changes to that weapon instantly with no delay, as switching is instant and free. So this is going to be interesting. It's not clear if you need all of the weapons on your robot at once. I have a suspicion that you're going to want to have all of those, or there's not going to be an option to have weapons, you know, revealed when say you click one and suddenly all your weapons change to plasma, click two, it changes to SMG or something like that. I think it's just going to, the weapons have to be present on the bot, but that's not really clear because we've not had a chance to actually play with that yet. Along with the loadout side is the introduction of energy. So all weapons and modules will consume power, which you can think of as a resource. It recharges over time, 100% recharge in 10 seconds, so similar to healing, except probably without the delay. If you use all of your power, then switch loadout. The weapon you switch to may not be out of fire, so you need to manage your power consumption carefully. So that's a good thing. All weapons and modules have separate recharge times, and they will have their own impact on your power usage. So I guess if something's recharging, it will drain power. If it's charged, then it's not going to need to drain anything. Has an impact on fire rate, resets to 100% on respawn, but recharge times do not reset on respawn. So that's important for things like the blink modules and all of those kinds of stuff. So they're still going to be recharging when you respawn. And weapon recharge times continue to count down even when a weapon is deselected. So that's definitely going to be an important thing, and it fixes a few potential balance issues in the event, say you switch between one, then you switch between two and switch back to one very quickly, using that as a way to circumvent the recharge timers is not going to work. And then all of the weapons are going to are basically being reworked or have been reworked to meet this. So hit scan weapons like rails and lasers are no longer going to exist. Instead, they're being changed to where you're going to need to lead your targets with all of those weapons. So lasers are going to have high velocity, but you're going to need to lead them, similar to like using aeroflak in terms of chances of hitting. Not sure how much that's going to need to be, but we'll find out definitely in the game. But lasers are apparently being optimized more for a medium range weapon. The plasma launcher is now firing projectiles separately or individually, so you can either click to fire individual bolts or you can hold down the button to fire a volley. But it will have an impact on how soon you can refire, because apparently the plasma is around 10 second recharge time for a full volley. So yeah, you can only do a full volley once every 10 seconds, which is kind of limiting, whereas at the moment you can actually do it more like once every 4 to 5 seconds. So yeah, although as a compensation they do a lot more damage. So Mega plasma now only fires one projectile. Rail cannons also work in a similar way. You'll be able to fire as many as your power will actually allow. So if you've got, if you somehow manage to get 11 on there, you'll be able to fire off 11 shots, but they're not going to be hit scan weapons, so you're still going to have to lead your targets and actually make sure you hit. Although they're supposed to be a lot faster than lasers, but we'll see how that works anyway. No more six gun limit in terms of optimization or damage DPS optimization, so you can put more than six guns and get all of them to fire, but you're going to have energy issues when you do that. I'm guessing they're probably going to optimize around 6 to 8 guns. Nano disruptors are now changing, so they're going to be doing the same round robin effect. You hold the button down, it's just going to activate each of them in short pulses and have some different, not quite the same healing effect, but yeah, again, a lot of this is purely speculative because until we get our hands on actually using these things, we're not going to know. Tesla blades are going to be interesting because instead of having the combines and stuff like that where it's a matter of trying to get in and destroy a robot in one hit, they're now being changed into a damage over time type weapon, so it's more like you have to hold it onto the enemy robot to actually deal damage. So that's going to definitely cause a lot of those Tesla designs to just go out of the window. They only open when they're selected, so you basically, it looks like Tesla blades are going to have their own loadout slot assigned to them, so it doesn't seem like you're going to be able to use SMGs while deploying Teslas at the same time. I'm not sure how well that's going to work, although with Teslas not getting destroyed anymore, you're not going to have to worry about healing them to regain ammo, but it's a pretty big change on those, so that will probably more only affect ground bots or slower robots. Aeroflak and rocket launcher aren't really changing much, but they're going to be using the power and recharge systems, which I'm not too surprised around because they're more used as core items, I would guess, to balance the rest of the game around now. Also, weapon turrets, the rotation speed on weapon turrets is being standardized, so everything rotates at the same rate, so there are no more issues with plasma taking longer to sight in than SMGs or rails taking forever to sight in. So in theory, wherever your cursor is pointing, so long as you're not moving it too fast, you should be able to hit. And then there's an email reward system, so you'll be able to get a 3 day of premium and another three days, so 4 days of premium based on confirming your email address. So basically the first time you log in on your account, you put your email address in, you'll get 1 day of premium for free. When you click the validation link, you'll get another 3 days. So that's 4 days of premium for everyone that's going to be coming from this update. And then other changes that are going to impact things, which are kind of hidden at the bottom in the other changes section, but are surprisingly important. You'll have more connection points for aerofoils and rudders, so anything that's using aerofoils, rudders, or at least larger ones, you're going to have to redesign your bots to make use of that, because you're not going to have all the connection points used that are available. Yeah, that's going to suck, but it's also going to make them a little bit more resilient anyway, because they're going to have more health, as well as having multiple connection points, which means the umbrella effect, where damage or part of the damage is transmitted into the robot, is going to be somewhat reduced because it gets split between more than one block. So there's multiple options there that are actually going to increase their health. They're also going to be a lot more agile, so they'll be able to turn and stuff more easily. Ground damage of Aeroflak is being reduced. Yay! Although no mention about Aeroflak having the height effects reduced for lower, you know, low down items. So I mean, not so yay on that, but at least reducing the ground damage should be a bonus. Health per volume factor on cubes increased. So slopes now have less health, for example. Hopefully this will deal with the Tesseract issue once and for all, because Tesseracts still have really high hit points for the weight, whereas now it looks like you're going to have more hit points for, or a lot more hit points for the bigger, for the full cubes as opposed to the little slim Tesseract style cubes. So we'll see where that comes out. Not sure if that means the armor on Tesseract is being decreased or what, but we'll find out when we actually get to seeing those updates, which, to be honest, by the time you read this, you're probably already going to be playing anyway. League system has already been updated, and so these are just some more general optimization things. Oh, another thing here, in Battle Arena you can get to overclock level 15. Not making that clear whether you can do that in TDM. Actually, TDM is lots overclocked, so yeah, in Battle Arena you can get to OC level 15, which means you can get a little bit more powerful, which is always going to be fun. Yeah, and some more optimizations to Battle Arena and general bug fixes. So yeah, that's pretty much going to be the maximum loadout update. I'll actually get into doing a proper video on different elements of this when we get to play with it in person, but that's not going to be until tomorrow night. So for a lot of you guys, that'll be Friday or the weekend, or Thursday even. Thursday, Friday, or the weekend. But anyway, so looking forward to this. Thank you very much for watching. Don't forget to subscribe. There's a subscribe link either there or up there or somewhere. And yeah, stay tuned and we'll see you next time. Goodbye.